clock is right. Okay, so yeah, I'm competing against an eclipse and possible zombie apocalypse, and I'm not doing well, I guess. So today I'm probably going to spend a bit more time on a couple different types of problems based on sort of the discussion that I've seen so far. And then this lecture and the next lecture will end vibration. And the following lecture, I have a very large set of slides that I have for the course synopsis. And I'm fine with it. But I also should mention that there is a summary video which you got in this week's announcements that has the same video with the same, almost the same material. I've updated it somewhat. And we'll see what happens. All right, so I have a wheel to which I've attached a spring and a damper. And I'm applying a force of 50 newtons. And that 50 newtons should actually be right there. The inner radius is 20 centimeters. The outer radius is 40. The mass of the spool is given as 9 kilograms. And this is sort of a different way of presenting it. But the moment of inertia of the spool is given as 0.8 kilogram meters squared. What is the position of the center as a function of time? So I have, I start the same place, which is I always start with a free body diagram showing the different forces that are applied to this system. And so I have a force pulling to the right, I have friction force which is opposing the motion, I have a damping force which is acting to the left, and I have a spring force which is acting to the left. And again, you'll notice that when I set this up, I set it up in a way that it works out for me. And so let's start looking at that. So I can look first at moments about G, and I have R inner K times S, which is the stretch of the spring, R outer force of friction minus R outer F. And again, oh, I did differently there. Anyways, R outer R inner. And all of that is equal to I G theta double dot. So I have all of that right away. I have a set of terms that describe what's happening. So I have, I have a counter clockwise rotation from KS. I have a counter clockwise rotation from, counterclockwise rotation from the friction force, and I have a clockwise rotation that's caused by this applied force F. All of that will equal IG theta double dot. And I can write this in terms of the force of friction because you'll notice that I didn't get any real information here. And if I do that, divide out by R outer, bring everything to the right-hand side, I now have a value for the first force of friction in terms of all of the remaining terms. I know IG, theta double dot, I'm going to solve for. Outer, inner, I'm given it's a ratio of 2 to 1. K is the spring constant, S I don't know much about, and I have this force, which is part of the problem. So the next step, is sum of forces in X, and maybe it would be good to do that. Sum of forces in X, I have minus KS plus or minus CX dot plus force plus force of friction equals mx double dot. So all of those terms add up together. I've got from my free body diagram. Whoop. Let's just make. There we go. The applied force F is acting to the right, force friction acting to the right, damping force, spring force are acting to the left, and they're negative. And they're negative because I want to have everything work out for me. So at this point, what I'm going to do is use equation one and substitute in for force of friction. And I will get mx double dot plus I G R inner over R outer theta double dot plus CX dot plus 3/2 KS is all equal to twice the friction. Now you'll notice that that works out really nicely because it splits up. So this is a forcing problem, but it's a constant force. I have double dot terms here that are positive. I have an X dot term and I have an S term. So I've kind of mixed up a lot of variables here. So in the process of mixing up variables, I need to sort of unmix them. So if I look at the kinematics, I can look at the displacement of the center, and I can argue that that is going to go as r outer times theta. So radius times arc length, it's a Gaussian condition, so that small displacements, everything's sort of good. The problem is my spring stretch. And it's wrapped around disk plus translation. So it will be S equals minus R inner theta minus R outer theta. And because I rushed through this as quickly as I could when I put it up on the board, R inner and R outer are a ratio of 1 to 2. So R outer is twice R inner, and I can put both of those together. So that is equal to 3 R inners times theta, which R times theta is 3/2 X. So combining all of this together, m plus I g over r outer squared x to the dot plus c x dot x equals 2f. I now have a form of the equation that looks exactly almost exactly as what I want. All of the terms on this side are positive. All of the terms on this side are sort of the forcing terms. If I change things a little bit so I don't have to keep writing things, and add them all up, I end up with x dot double dot plus twice d x dot plus omega squared x is equal to a. D is equal to c over 2m, which is 4/29 rads per second. Zeta, if you're counting, 0.713, which means what?
I like this text because it's good for sort of using zeta.
So zeta is your damping coefficient. Remember that if it's equal to 1, then you have critical damping. If it's greater than 1, it's overdamped. If it's less than 1, it's underdamped. So in this case, you should know immediately that it's an underdamped case. So the natural circular frequency for this is 6.01 rads per second. So that's good. You got that from the equation, the way it's written. If you solve through, x particular is going to be a divided by omega squared, which is equal to 8f divided by 9k, which equals 0.1975 meters. The damped natural frequency of this is equal to 4.22 rads per second. Again, I'm not doing a lot of work here because I've already done everything. Once I set up this problem here, I've solved it. That is, I have to make sure that I'm going to end up with a form of the equation that looks like this. X double dot plus a constant times x dot plus another constant times x is equal to some final value. Now, again, notice here, omega squared is not square root of k over m in this particular case. But omega squared is whatever ends up in front of the x term in that expression. So the solution is going to be x particular. Okay, so for x particular, I have omega d. My solution is going to be c1 e to the minus zeta omega n t times the quantity sine of omega d t plus psi, plus 8f divided by 9k. So adding all of the terms up, putting everything together, I end up with a solution that looks like this, minus 0.282 e to the minus 0.713 times 6 t times sine of 4.22 t plus 0.778 plus 0.1975. And the question asked for x at time equals 0.4 seconds and 0.1658 meters. Any questions? again, as much as possible, as you're going through these problems, don't overthink what you're asked for. Draw out the free body diagram, draw out the solution, or set it up in the standard format, and once you get rid of all of the extra terms, you're set, you're done. Don't make it more than that. Any questions? I'm fighting an eclipse. I don't know how long I can last. Okay, I'll probably do this example. And while I do appreciate greatly that you're here, I may sort of end at this point, unless there's anything pressing. I'm happy to talk afterwards, but I think that it will be either this video is available, and I think that's okay. So I have a thingamabob, which is sort of H and D. I have H, which is 850 millimeters, D, which is equal to 520 millimeters, and K of the springs is the same on both sides of this, and it is 430 newtons per meter. And you're asked for the period for a mass M at which tau is equal to 0.5 seconds, and infinity. So, so this is a spring. The spring is being stretched on the left-hand side by a distance x sub s and compressed on the right-hand side by a distance x sub s. So the resultant force is 2F because both springs are stretched or compressed by the same amount, and they want to return in the same direction. So they're going to be pushing in the same direction. You have weight, and that's at the top, and that's a displacement x. You also have the reaction forces at the pin, ax, ay, and pin a. And I'm just going to say M X double dot, and there. Now again, remember that all of these problems have the same assumption, which is this is a very small oscillation. So I have grievously sort of exaggerated the motion of this mass and spring, but by doing this, just remember that I'm kind of allowed to sort of say it's just a horizontal. It's not very much, and it falls within that sort of special zone. Yeah, so I'm doing the free body diagram of this. So first of all, I have a mass, I have K, and when this sort of goes off to here, it compresses the spring by a distance x of s on the right hand. And it stretches the spring by a distance x sub s on the left-hand side. So the spring on the left-hand side is stretched and wants to return to the left. And so it's pulling in this direction. It's compressed on the right-hand side and pushing to the left also. So I'm setting this up so I can do a moment example. Okay, weight is going to play a role. It's also slightly shifted. It will stay off to the side. But it's driving the flow, or driving the vibration. I have similar triangles. So as the spring is sort of stretched and compressed, it's going to the right. It's going to sort of fight. And 2F, which is the spring force, is 2KXS, which equals 2KD over HX. So if I do sum of moments about A, I have 2FD, which is a counterclockwise moment. Minus mgx, which equals minus mx double dot h, because it's going to go down, 2k times d over hx d minus mgx equals minus mx double dot times h. And x double dot is equal to, or plus, 2kd squared mh squared minus g over h times x is equal to 0. So this is kind of interesting because, again, it's a standard-looking spring damp or a spring force, free vibration, but with rigid bodies. And this term here is my natural natural circular frequency. And so this is what I'm looking at. It's not square root of k over m, which is the standard sort of thing you look at, especially in a case like this where you kind of ignore the mass of the rod, but you worry about the mass of the mass. So omega n squared is equal to 2kd squared over m h squared minus g over h, which equals 2k over m d over h squared minus g over h. D equals 520 millimeters. H equals 850 millimeters, and K is 430 newtons per meter. So tau equals 0.5 is just going to be omega n equals 4 pi. And so if I put that back into 1, omega n equals 4 pi, that will yield a mass equal to 1.9 kilograms. And for the second part, tau approaches infinity. Omega n approaches 0, and the mass is equal to 27.9 kilograms. And so again, you're just using definition here. You're not doing anything spectacular in terms of analysis. You just need to set the problem up correctly. And I think that's the last gasp for my effort to fight the eclipse. I will see you on Wednesday, non-eclipsed, unless the zombies come to get you. Yeah. I'm happy to talk. I just know that at this stage, it's probably good to let everybody. I can do another example. I'm happy. Okay. All right. I just want to, I know that this, there are certain things you don't fight.
So for the model we did for this question, this means that the mass will oscillate like infinity.
Yeah. So the time period means that there's no real oscillation. It's just going to stop, and so it will sort of, you know, when you put the solution together, you have tau approaches infinity, which means omega n equals 0, which means 0 in your solution, which is, you know, a sine omega nt plus cos omega nt. So one term is 0, a equals b.
And so, sorry, just one question. The relation between tau and omega n is just
That's correct. And so you, I didn't write that. There we go. And again, these are all definitions. So I'm not doing anything that is particularly clever in these problems. I'm just setting them up so that when I have my equation of motion over here, there. When I have that equation of motion, I'm done. I've done everything I need to do. That's the analysis. Everything else beyond this becomes just applying the standard sort of definitions for omega and all of the rest. I had another set of problems I brought with me that I thought I was going to do. Let's do a kind of, okay, so again, I'm not fighting the eclipse, all right? I'm not going to fight the eclipse. If you want to go, go now, go ahead. But let's see. This is week 13, good. All right, so this is lecture. No, I don't. All right, let's do something a little bit more basic. I have a spring mass system. And I've done, I think, some somewhat complicated cases. This is a really simple case in the sense that it's just a mass hanging down on, and the only addition to this problem that I've done is add in this forcing, which is 7 sine 8 t. So I have a mass of 5 kilograms. It's suspended from that spring, which has a 300 newtons per meter. Kilograms, and there is a vertical force of 7 sine 8 t. T is in seconds. And pulled down 8 millimeters or 100 millimeters. And release from rest. So it's going to be the same sort of thing. I have the weight, I have spring, I have all of the things there, and you know, the starting point is always the same. I have the mass. So I have the weight, which is acting down. In the spring, plus I have this forcing. So let's give that a different color. Seven sine eight t. When I finish all of this stuff, I know what the form is going to be. So just y and x. And what I want is sort of K delta static plus y negative sum of forces in the y direction, plus mg is equal to f, which is that 7 sine 8t. Plus f, which equals mx double dot. And what I'm kind of used to at this point is I just get rid of these two terms right away, and I have the standard form of the equation that I'm used to, which is m, and I have the standard form of the equation, I just have to write it that way, my double dot plus ky equals f. So that's the equation I get from just doing the same analysis we did at the first set of lectures when we were looking at free vibration, but now I have this forcing term. And by including that forcing term, y equals 7 sine 8t. By including that term, I have everything that I need. Okay, yep, everything works. My double dot, ky, dot, dot. And I know what my solution looks like. Y is equal to a sine omega nt plus b cos omega nt plus a horrible mix of things, 1 minus, omega forcing over omega n, quantity squared, sine of omega forcing times t. And I should keep that together. Again, I'm not really doing a lot of thinking. At this point, I don't worry about anything that happens because now I have this governing equation. Once I have that governing equation, I have everything that I need to solve this problem. And so I have a sine omega nt, b cos omega nt, f naught over k, the forcing, I've got sort of that magnification factor appearing. And at y equals 0.1 meter, I know that y equals 0 at t equals 0. So 0.1 at time equals 0. This term goes to 0. This term stays, so it's b plus, or b plus 0. There. So it's 0 plus 0. Or 0 plus b plus 0. The first term is a sine, the last term is a sine, both of those go away, b is equal to 0.1. So y dot is equal to a, I did cheat a little bit, but y is equal to a sine 7.746t plus b cos of 7.746t plus, over the nightmare here, 3/100ths, 1 minus 8 over 7.746. Quantity squared times sine of 8t. So if I know that, I already know b is equal to 0.1. I can then start to substitute other terms. And so for the other term, I need to look at y dot, and that is equal to a times 7.746 times cos of 7.746t minus b times 7.746 sine of 7.746, okay, minus 0.3. 3, 5, when you put the numbers together, 8 cos of 8t. So that's everything there, but I need to recognize that it starts from rest. So y dot at time equals 0 is 0. So y dot then, is equal to 7.746a minus 2.8, which equals 0, at t equals 0, and y dot, or a is equal to 0.361. So y is equal to 361 sine of 7.75t plus 100 cos of 7.75t minus 350 sine of 8t, but these are in units of millimeters. So I could multiply across by 1,000. So I have, a relatively simple problem. This is one you have, we talked about at the very beginning for free vibration, where we had, first of all, a horizontal displacement, but then followed it up with a vertical displacement, and you get rid of the weight term by sort of including. Sorry, any questions? Yeah, so remember that every time we write these, and I saw this on Piazza, one of the other instructors, what they do is they refer to it as weight, and it's correct, but I think it's a little bit easier not to mix it up. But if you have K, and you just go into the static equilibrium case, you have weight that acts downward, and the counteracting stretch in the spring is K delta ST. And K delta ST, and the way I've defined this coordinate system, mg minus k delta st is equal to 0. And that's the case where I just gently hold the mass and I drop it slowly until the spring takes it up. And when the spring takes it up, it has to counteract the weight. And that's my new 0. I don't try and define everything with respect to the starting point. So if you look at this term right here, you look at here, I now have the same thing, which is minus k delta st, which is acting upwards because of the way I've defined the coordinate system, that is negative. I have weight, which is acting downwards, that's positive. And these two terms cancel, and I'm able to do my analysis. Yeah, the spring is stretched. So it's as if, so I take the spring, I have the mass, and then I gently let it drop until the spring takes it up. And the spring force will balance out, and it's, you know, an exercise you can do at home. Take apart one of your pens and put a block on the end of it, and you'll see. And then you can oscillate it slightly. So plus y is I have displaced it from that point, and now I'm going to let it oscillate. So it's going to oscillate around its static equilibrium point, not the 0 point that I started with. So not the unstretched length of the spring. That's correct. And then I let it go. And when I let it go, it's driven by this stretch and this acceleration.
Since I'm drawing things out today. So I have a spring. And I have a force that's being applied to the end of this rod of F naught sine omega t. So I have two springs. Same thing as the first, one of the first examples that I did at the beginning. I have the springs, which are the same spring constants. And I have a uniform rod of mass m. So it's a uniform rod of mass m. You know that the only tricky bit in this particular problem is going to be I'm going to have to deal with the moment of inertia. So uniform rod. I have a force that's applied, and I can start to look at this particular problem. Ooh. So again, I am exaggerating this right here, but the first thing I do is I draw out all of my terms. I have a force of the spring or a force at the pin. I have twice the force of the spring. So again, wrong way. So I bring it over to the sort of swinging it a little bit clockwise, and the spring force in both cases are going to be acting to the right. What else do I have? I've been told the distances are L over 2. I'm going to get away with a lot in these problems because I don't worry about the orientation too much. The orientation doesn't play much of a role because I'm assuming small order vibrations, they're not doing very much to change or organization. This is going to be just an annoying problem because I'm going to have clockwise as positive. So this is G, and the spring stretch is going to be RAG theta. So arc length times this distance. I'm kind of playing games here, which is equal to L over 2 theta. The force in the springs is equal to Ks, which equals K L over 2 theta. And IA of this is 1/3 M L squared. So I know that it's the length of the rod is L, the mass is M, and I have to consider that because that's what you do. So sum of moments about A. I have 1/3. I have F naught sine of omega t cos theta
over L. All right, so that's, maybe I should define theta. So theta's there. Okay, that's good. Minus mg times sine theta L over 2. Sine theta at L over 2, okay. Minus 2 k L over 2 theta cos theta times L over 2. And all of that is equal to 1 third m L squared theta done. Okay, all right, I'm good. That's all the terms there. And magically, I've done the right thing. The forcing term will stay on the left-hand side as a positive value. These two terms are negative, and it's because I cheated in terms of writing out my coordinate system. I probably should have rotated it the other way, but okay. But in any case, I end up with a coordinate system that works. I have everything there, and I can say, 1/3 ml theta double dot plus 1/2 mg plus kl theta equals f naught sine of omega t. And again, in these cases, cos theta for small vibrations is 1, and sine theta for small vibrations is theta. So I'm making that small vibration, small angle sort of assumption. I end up with this governing equation that I can work with. My particular solution is going to be just sine, because it's the forcing is sine omega t. And if I put that in, theta double dot particular is equal to minus c omega squared sine omega t. And after all of this mess, I will end up with minus c omega squared sine omega, find the steady state solution, which means I don't care about the complementary solution in this case, because that normally goes to zero, and we talked about this last week. Equals 3f naught divided by ml sine omega t. And if you substitute all of that in, you end up with c 3/2 g over l plus k over m minus omega squared sine omega t is equal to 3 f naught ml sine omega t, and c is equal to, after all of this mess, 3 f naught over 3/2 mg plus lk minus ml omega squared. All right, and you get from that solution for the steady state case, you have C in that particular case, and you have everything based on sort of the displacement. Any questions on that in the 22 seconds that remain? These are just good problems to look at. Again, as much as possible, as you're preparing for the final exam, as you're preparing for all of this, look and solve these problems on your own. And as you